Well, welcome to church this morning. I'm glad that you're here. It's good to be together as a church family, even in the summer months. I hope that you're enjoying some of the nice weather outside, maybe even getting a vacation and getting away from Illinois or away from your house. But when you're in town, it's good to be together because we want to worship the Lord and be in God's Word. So if you're here this morning and you have a copy of God's Word, either in front of you or on your phone, if you can go to Joshua chapter 2. That's where we're going to be today, Joshua chapter 2. And as you are turning there, I want to share with you that Pastor Jason Akers, our campus pastor at the Deerfield Road campus, is resigning his position. That's being announced this morning at our Deerfield Road campus. His resignation letter per policy is on our website, so if you want to read that, you're welcome to do that. But let's make sure that we're praying for our Deerfield Road campus during this time of transition. We are in the middle of a summer series called Unsung: Ordinary People, Uncommon Faith. We're looking at just ordinary people, regular people like you and me who have uncommon faith. A faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction, the confidence of things unseen. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And so we want to be a people of faith, but we don't want to just be a people of faith. We want to be a people of growing faith. Turn to your neighbor and say, I want to grow in my faith. I believe that that's true. That's why you are here today, is that this summer we want to be growing in our faith, and we're growing in our faith by looking at ordinary people in the Bible. So far, we've looked at the ordinary people of the four friends of the paralytic. Do you remember them and their relentless faith? We've looked at the woman with the bleeding issue and her reckless faith. We've looked at Barnabas and his restoring faith. Last week, we looked at one of the thieves on the cross and his redeeming faith. Today, we're looking at Rahab and her risky faith. The title of this message is Rahab's Faith, Risking It All to Have It All. If we were to play Family Feud right now, and the category was Rahab, top answers on the board that come to your mind as you think of Rahab, what would be the answers on the board? Prostitute, liar, Canaanite. Although those things are true, and we will see those things in the text today, the emphasis both in the Old and New Testament regarding Rahab are really not those things. It's the fact that she is a woman of faith, that she is forgiven, and that she is one who has an incredible faith in the Lord. And that's what we are going to see today. But before we get into her life in Joshua chapter 2, we needed to kind of tell the story to see how we even got to where we're at today. So back in the book of Exodus, you remember that the Israelites were in slavery in Egypt. And God raised up Moses and the 10 plagues and delivered his people from Egypt, from slavery. And as they were leaving Egypt, they came to a big obstacle. The obstacle was the Red Sea, but God parted the Red Sea and they crossed over on dry ground. You remember that? And then as the Egyptian army was pursuing them, the sea closed up and the soldiers and the horsemen and the chariots were drowned in the sea. And God continued to provide for his Israelite people, and he provided a pillar of cloud to lead them by day, a pillar of fire to lead them by night. He provided manna for the journey, but the Israelites grumbled and complained all along the way. They get to Sinai, and Moses goes up on top of Sinai, and he meets with the Lord, and God gives him the Ten Commandments as he's coming down Sinai. The Israelites are in flat-out rebellion, worshiping a golden calf, and the Israelites who were on their way to the promised land need to take a detour. For 40 years, they wander in a wilderness long enough so a whole generation dies off. That the promised land wasn't going to be for them, but it was going to be for their children. And we get to the end of Deuteronomy, the beginning of Joshua, and Moses, the leader of the Israelite people, dies. He's able to see the promised land at a distance, but he's never able to experience it for himself. Along the way, God is raising up Joshua to lead the Israelite people after Moses. We're first introduced to Joshua in Numbers chapter 13. He, along with Caleb, were two of the 12 spies that went into Cana, into the land flowing with milk and honey, but they came back and 10 of them had a report that, yes, this is an amazing land, but the people are big. I don't know that God can do it. But yet Moses or Joshua and Caleb had faith, and God's favor was on Joshua, and he's beginning to lead the Israelite people. As we turn to Joshua chapter 1, and in Joshua chapter 1, we see those very famous words, "Do not let the book of the law depart from your mouth, but meditate on it day and night so that you'll be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and very courageous. Do not be discouraged. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." I don't know what you're bringing into church today, but chances are all of us are bringing in different struggles and different trials. May that be a word for each of us. Don't be discouraged. Don't be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Amen? And so now we get to turn to Joshua chapter 2, but before we do, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to even hold your word in our laps today. Thank you for being a God who has revealed yourself to us. And God, I pray that you would speak to us through your word. God, I pray that you would use even the faith of Rahab to inspire us. God, we thank you that you are a God who is at work, not just in the past, but in the present. We trust you to be at work even into the future. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So Joshua chapter 2, starting in verse 1, it says this, "And Joshua the son of Nun sent two men secretly to Shittim as spies." I'm thankful for the Hebrew pronunciation of that city and not the English version of that, and all of God's people say Shittim. And so Joshua sent these men secretly from Shittim as spies. Shittim is this area just on the east side of the Jordan River. It's just north of the Dead Sea, and directly across from Shittim is going to be Jericho, and they are days away from going into this promised land that they have been waiting so long for. And so Joshua sends in two spies on a recon mission to be able to check out the land, specifically Jericho, and he says to them, "Go view the land, especially Jericho." And so they went, and they came to the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab, and they lodged there. They came to the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab. Most prostitutes are nameless to their Johns. They're seen as objects, not as people. They're seen as a means to a very selfish end. Sometimes we, when we think about a profession like this or images that we can see on a computer screen, we begin to dehumanize someone who is very much human, who is a daughter, who is a sister, who is loved by God. We don't know much about Rahab before this. What was it that led her into this profession? How and why did she become this? What was her family of origin like? I think sometimes we as Christians can be so quick and so harsh and so loud in our judgment, and we lack compassion for someone who's in a struggle. Think about Jesus and how he related to the prostitutes, the tax collectors, and the sinners. Did he shame those who are already feeling shame? Did he pile on wounds to those who are already wounded? Sometimes we in our self-righteousness can do those things. May that not be said of us. And so here is a woman who happens to be a prostitute. Why does the text even say that? Don't you think the text could say that the spies entered the house of a woman named Rahab? Why drag up all of this? Well, I think that it's clear that everyone is able to experience the grace of God. That no one, there's no sin, including sexual sin, that is unable to experience God's grace. For sure, that would be true. But I think that it's included here because I think it's going to turn people who have a sense of self-righteousness on their heads, realizing that here is this non-Jewish woman who sells her body for a living. She is the one that's going to be the hero of this story. And it's her faith that is going to be highlighted in this story. And so we see that the two spies, that they go and they go to her house. And her house is literally not just on the wall, but it's in the wall of the outer wall of Jericho. The Lord led the spies to this house, not because the place was available, but because her heart was available as well. It appears that she's the only one in Jericho who believes in Yahweh God, and so God brought the spies to her. And Rahab was risking her own life by welcoming the spies into her house, which is evidence of her faith and her allegiance to the Lord. And so here we see that they enter into her house as spies. Evidently, they're not very good spies. You would think that being a spy, you would want to be kind of covert in what you're doing. It doesn't seem like they're even in Jericho for 10 seconds, and the king already knows that the spies are there, and maybe they need to go back to spy school or something like that, but they're already in Rahab's house, and the king knows this, and of course the king is not a big fan of having spies inside the walls of Jericho. And so when it was told to the king, verse 2, behold, the men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land, the king wants to get a message to them so that he can meet with them. And so he sends messengers to Rahab's house. Think about this. If you were to have a Russian spy hiding out in your basement, and the FBI or the CIA were to know that, who do you think is going to be showing up at your house? This is about what's going to happen to Rahab, but Rahab already has an allegiance to the Lord, an allegiance to God's people, and that's going to be very clear even in her response. So the king sends messengers, he sends an army, he sends policemen to her house, and when they come, they say to her in verse 3, bring out the men who have come to you, who have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land. But Rahab already knew what she was going to do, and Rahab had already taken the two men and had hidden them. And so she said to these men, she said, true, these men came here, but I don't know where they're from. And when the gate was about to be closed at dark, these men, they went out, and I don't know where they went, but maybe you can pursue them quickly, and you're going to find them and overtake them. But Rahab had brought them up onto the roof and had hidden them in the stalks of flax that she had laid there out on order on the roof. When you think of flax, what do you think of? When I think of flax, I think of a game that I played with my grandma Bedford back when I was in grade school. It was the game called Pit. Anyone know Pit? It's a game with commodity cards, and you have all these cards, and you're trying to collect your commodities, and there's a bull card and a bear card, and you're not wanting to get that unless you're going to be going out, and there's different levels of cards, and you don't want to have flax. Flax was like the worst value of cards. So when I'm reading this in this text, I'm thinking about flax, and I'm thinking about my childhood, and I'm thinking about Pitt. But I'm realizing that's not going to be helpful for you at church, so I tried to do some research on why would flax be on the house. Would you appreciate that I would bring more to flax than my experience as a kid playing a card game? So flax would have been harvested, and it would have been put on top of a roof, and the roofs would have been flat back in that day, and the flax would have been put there, and they would have been dried out, and when they were dried out, they would have been bundled up, and then when they were bundled up, they were about 3 or 4 feet high. So there the spies could have hidden, and then the flax was then taken and crushed and created into what? Created into fiber, which would then led to creating linens and other things like that. And so that was a commodity back then. And so she had these flax up on the roof. So she goes and hides these spies in the house because she understands the messengers are going to be coming. And the messengers are like, where are they? And she's like, they're already out the door. You can go chase after them. And so then we see, so then the men, she diverted them and the men began to pursue them on their way on the Jordan as the fords, verse 7. And the gate was shut as soon as the pursuers had gone out. So the gate was shut so no one could leave and no one could come and go. So that's what's happening here. So they're coming. These messengers are looking for the spies, and she's already hidden them, and she's like, go and find them. And was Rahab being deceptive? Was Rahab lying? What do we do with the morality of this text in Rahab lying? Well, there's really like four views of this. Track with me here. There's four views: the clash of absolutes, the never lie, the grace, and then lying is not an emphasis. Let's look first at the clash of absolutes. That one is justified in lying when forced between protecting human life versus telling the truth. This would go back to even in the days of the Nazis during the Holocaust. If there were Germans who were hiding Jews in their house and the German soldiers were to show up and like, are you hiding Jews? No, we're not hiding Jews. Is that right or is that wrong? Is that a clash of absolutes? Some would say never lie. It's always wrong to lie. Therefore, it was wrong for Rahab to lie, even in this instance. Some would say grace. They would view this with grace, that although Rahab had salvation, as we're going to see, she wasn't yet fully formed in her sanctification. She wasn't mature in her morality yet. She knew some things about God, but she had a limited knowledge of God, and perhaps we're asking too much out of her. And a fourth view is that lying is not the emphasis of this narrative, that Rahab's deception is not the concern of the story, but rather the focus of her personal risk in hiding the spies. What do you think is the correct view of those four? Perhaps there's validity in each one of those views. Scripture doesn't commend her deceit in any way, but it doesn't condemn her deceit either. It doesn't seem like it's the pressing thing in this passage, and so I don't want to get too distracted or begin to debate this. I'll allow you to land your own convictions, but it's clear that Rahab's faith was demonstrated in the receiving of the Israelite spies and risking her own life to protect them. Her allegiance was with God. And so that is point number one, is to re-examine your allegiance. Point number two is this, recognize God's power. Recognize God's power. Let's continue the narrative starting in verse 8. So before the men, before the spies lay down, she went up to them up on the roof. They were up there with the flax, and she said, I know that the Lord has given you the land. That takes a lot of faith right there. She's pretty convicted that the Lord had given, Yahweh had given them the land. She had more faith than the 10 spies who had gone out to scout out the land sooner than that. And so she is declaring that she knows that the Lord has given them the land, and the fear of you has fallen upon us and the inhabitants of this land. melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who are beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and to Og, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on earth beneath. And so she hears some things about God and what God had already done. She heard about the Red Sea and how God had provided for them and how God had defeated all these other armies. She heard about these things. Just think about that. Back before social media, back before the internet. How many of you remember life before the internet, before Al Gore invented the internet? Is that what? Back before cell phones, in landlines, in telegraphs, back before dish TV, and televisions. How many of you remember those days? That's going to date you a bit. How is it that she's finding out about it? Word is coming, and she hears these things. And she hears these things, and she believes these things, and then she acts upon her beliefs. And so you can see her, that she makes a pretty strong profession of faith in Yahweh God. And you can see in verse 11, basically she's saying, I believe in your God, the God of Israel. He's the one true God. Yahweh is the supreme God above pagan gods. She's believing in her heart and confessing with her mouth, which leads to the next point, remove the barriers, verses 12 through 14. It says this, now please swear to me, this is her talking to the spies, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you also will deal kindly with my father's house, and give me a sure sign that you will save alive my father and my mother, my brothers and my sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death. And the men said to her, the spies said to her, our life for yours, even to death. If you do not tell this business of ours, when the Lord gives us the land, we'll deal kindly and faithfully with you. So she's realizing that the judgment of God is coming to the Canaanite people because of their actions. But she's pleading for mercy and grace. Mercy and grace are two sides of the same coin. What is mercy? Mercy is what? Not getting what we deserve. And then grace, the other side of the coin, is getting what? Getting something we don't deserve. Now, if you're a parent or have been a parent of kids, no doubt you've had a chore system in your house of some sort, and you told your kids that they needed to do their chores, and if they did their chores, then blessing would come their way, and if they didn't do their chores, then punishment would come their way. Well, you have a child who didn't do his chores yesterday, and so he needs to stay in his room, and he cannot watch Lion King version 1990s on your TV streaming system. But mercy says, goes into the room and says, no, you can come out of the room. Grace takes that further, not just come out of the room, why don't you hop in the car, and why don't we drive to the movie theater, and why don't we go see the new Lion King on the big screen, and I'm going to buy you a bucket of popcorn and one of those big boxes of candy, whatever you want, and a 32-ounce thing of sugary soda. Now that is grace. How many of you have seen The New Lion King, by the way? It's a pretty cool movie, but it's very predictable. It's the same movie. And we went and saw it, Camille and I, and Hannah saw it, and there was this lady who was, like, sitting next to me, this mom, and, like, she's, like, so angry that, like, Mufasa is, you know, Scar lets go of Mufasa, and he dies, and I'm like, did you not know that that was going to happen already? She was totally into the movie, and anyways, Sidebar. Back to the message. So mercy is not giving someone what they deserve as punishment. Grace is giving them blessing. She knows the punishment is coming. Does she deserve punishment? Yes. But she begs for mercy, and she begs for grace. Grace not just for herself, but she begs for grace for her own family. Is she the only one that deserves punishment because of her profession? And what about me as a pastor? Do I deserve punishment? Yes. But God is merciful and God is gracious. This is the essence of the gospel here. And we're going to see it continue to play out in her story. And so she's asking for grace that her family can be protected. She knows the walls are going to be coming down shortly. And so the spies make a pledge to her. This isn't like the pinky promise thing that you do like as a little kid, but this is like a legit oath that they're like, we'll take care of you. And it's not just we'll give you our words, but we're going to give you our lives. And moving on to the next point. The next point is respond with obedience, starting in verse 15. And so she let down the spies down a rope through the window, for her house was built into the city wall. And she said to them, go into the hills, for your pursuers are going to try to encounter you, but hide there for 3 days, and when your pursuers return, then afterward you may go your way. And so she's basically sending them to like the north and the west where the hills are, because she had sent the others to the south and to the east to the Jordan River. Go hide it for 3 days, and then you can go back across the Jordan River. And then the men said to her that, we will be guiltless. You have made us guiltless with respect to the oath of yours that you have made us swear. Behold, when we come into the land, into Canaan, into Jericho, you shall tie this scarlet cord through the window which you let us down, and you shall gather into your house your father and your mother and your brothers and your father's household. And if anyone goes into the doors into your house and or out of the doors into your house into the street, his blood will not be on our head and we'll be guiltless. But if a hand is laid on anyone who is within your house, his blood will be on our head. And if you tell of your business to others, then we'll be guiltless with respect to your oath that you have made us swear. And she said, according to your words, so be it. And then she sent them on their way, and they departed, and she tied the scarlet cord right away. She tied the scarlet cord in the window, and they departed. They went up to the hills, and verse 24, they make their way back to Joshua, and they say that the land is amazing. And so there's a lot that's happening in these verses. The spies are giving her a lot of instructions. They're saying to her, don't tell anyone. Get your family together. Tie this cord. And she responds in obedience. Obedience requires faith. That we don't walk in obedience. We don't walk in obedience because we don't walk in faith. That if you think about that, oftentimes when you're struggling with obeying, it's you're struggling with faith. And when your faith is strong, you're obeying. And that's what's happening with her. And notice that they say, tie this cord. What color is the cord, by the way? Color? Scarlet. Do you think that that's significant? Do you think that's symbolic? Absolutely. Let's think about that, that it's significant and symbolic if you're looking backwards. If you're looking backwards to Exodus chapter 12 in the Passover, the scarlet crimson blood of that of the lamb that was slain, that they spread on the doorposts and the lintels of the house. So as the Spirit of God came over Egypt, the Spirit of God did what? He passed over the house. That as we're going to see, and Joshua 6, as the Israelites crossed the Jordan River, and as they began to march around Jericho. You remember that story? 6 days they march around once. The seventh day they march around the seventh time. On the seventh time they're blowing their trumpets and they're yelling. And what happens? The walls come tumbling down. But yet God, in the midst of that, spares Rahab and her household, passes over them. The scarlet cord, for sure, significant symbolism looking back. But what about the significance and the symbolism looking forward? The crimson blood of Jesus Christ himself. Jesus Christ, Lamb of God, who came to take away the sins of the world. A few moments ago, we celebrated communion, the body of Christ broken, the blood of Christ shed for your forgiveness and mine. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. That forgiveness is possible through faith in Jesus Christ. That Jesus Christ paid the penalty that we owe that we could not pay. He took on the punishment. Think about that. We deserve punishment and death. That's what we deserve. He took on the punishment, the weight of our sin. He took on death himself, dying and then conquering death and rising from the grave. Amen? That's not just an Easter message, that's a today message. Amen? That he conquered death by rising again so that we could experience mercy and grace, so that we could experience not punishment and death, but forgiveness and life. That's what he offers. And so for Rahab, it was having the faith to put this scarlet cord. Was her faith in the scarlet cord? Faith was not in the scarlet cord itself, but her faith was in Yahweh God and who that scarlet cord represented. And we see now, the last point is this, is that we get to experience the reward of our faith. Reap the rewards. So what happens with Rahab? Well, Rahab was willing to risk it all. She took risks to harbor the spies. She took risks to ask for her own safety. She took risks by putting out the scarlet cord, you know, outside of her window. But she did so, she took these risks because she had faith. And because of her faith, she's in heaven with Jesus today. Amen? And so... we see that God had spared her, and we see her story played out in the book of Joshua. But did you know that Rahab is mentioned 3 times in the New Testament? She's mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11 is the hall of faith. These are the great characters who demonstrated a faith in Yahweh God. And this is where we get the verse, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And it lists out all of these characters. Did you know that there are 2 women that are mentioned? Sarah and, of course, who? Rahab. And Hebrews chapter 11 says this regarding Rahab in verse 31. By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were being... with those who were disobedient, because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. She's commended for her faith in the hall of faith. How amazing is that? Then in James chapter 2, a couple of pages over, talking about without faith, without works is dead, talks first about Abraham, and then in verse 25, and in the same way, was it not also Rahab, the prostitute, justified by works, when she received the messengers and she sent them out another way? For the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. So was Rahab saved because of her works? No, she wasn't saved because of her works. She was saved because of her faith. and because of her faith, it led to works. You're not saved by baptism. You're not saved by doing good things, but when you are saved, you take steps of faith and obedience like those things. And so she demonstrated her faith in those ways. So she's mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. She's mentioned in James chapter 2. She's also mentioned in Matthew chapter 1. Rahab, later after this story that we read, she went on to marry an individual by the name of Salmon. And together, they had a son named Boaz. Boaz, we're introduced in the book of Ruth, and Boaz and Ruth give birth to Obed. Obed is the father of Jesse. Jesse, of course, is the father of 8 sons, including King David. Rahab is mentioned in Matthew chapter 1 in the genealogy of Jesus Christ himself. Rahab makes Jesus' family tree. How crazy is that? You can see in verse 5, and Salmon, the father of Boaz, by Rahab. I guarantee you that Rahab had no idea the outcome that was going to come from her choice to place her faith in Yahweh God over the pagan gods of the Canaanites. Don't you think there were days in Rahab's life where she's looking at her messy and messed up life? Is anything good going to come out of my life? And yet it was her act of obedience that led to generational blessings. May the story of Rahab be a story of God's grace. I don't know what you bring into church this morning in terms of regret about your past or struggles in the present. But there is no one that is too far from experiencing God's grace. That God wants to, through his Son, Jesus Christ, through the Son, has set us free. He is free indeed. He wants to set you free. He wants to set you free from the guilt and the shame and the heartache of your past. He wants to set you free from the struggles that you experience today. But it begins with having faith. Perhaps you're going to be the first in your family to have faith in Jesus Christ and to think about the lineage that can follow. Perhaps you're the first in your family that's going to break the bondage of addiction or divorce or dysfunction for generations to follow. The steps of faith that you're taking today could have an impact not just on your life presently, but in generations to come, so that your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren will look to your faith. Let's be a people who are living by faith. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for working in ordinary sinful people, like even Rahab. Because we know that if you have worked in her life, that you could work in our lives. We thank you that our flaws are not final, but that we can find grace and mercy at the foot of the cross. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to set us free. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to be our Savior, to rescue us. Thank you, Jesus.